Suzanne DeLee Flanders Larson was born on December 6, 1924, in Chicago, Illinois, a first child for Lester and Addie Larson. Although 1 year and 1 month prior to Suzanne's birth, Addie did give birth to a full-term baby girl. She died and was buried in an unmarked grave in Tulsa, Oklahoma. At the time of Suzanne's birth, they had been married 15 years. Les was 42 years old and Addie 38. When Suzanne was 9 months old, the Larson family moved to Minneapolis, Minnesota, where Les became the division manager for the Utilities Exchange Commission, the power company owned by Sam Insull, the infamous utilities magnate, who several years later became the national scoundrel when he tried to run off with his customers' money, was hunted by Hoover's FBI, and found on a Greek freighter in a crate. The Larsons settled into a comfortable upper-middle-class life in their newly adopted Minneapolis home, and within 3 years, Suzanne had two baby sisters, Kathleen and Victoria. Although throughout their formative years, they were mostly identified as baby and sister. Victoria was baby and Kathleen was sister. Suzanne, however, remained Suzanne and was clearly the queen bee early on.
In all New York, the peach crop's always fine. They're sweet and fair, and on the square, the maze of Manhattan for mine. You can't...
Les's mother was Althena Garrison, and for me, the genealogical mystery. She eventually revealed to me that her great-great-grandfather was a Revolutionary War officer and was buried along with his wife and children in an ancient cemetery that I have been driving and living by for my 18 years in Putnam County, New York, a place where I had no ties, except that as my own chronic chaos burned itself out, it was simply where the fading twist of Bedlam blew me, via London and Los Angeles, to take a stand for my own almost out-of-reach children. David Crosby and Reliance Hopkins were the Revolutionary War ancestors who were buried in my backyard. And after a little more digging, I found that Reliance's great-great-grandfather was Stephen Hopkins, a prominent passenger of the 102 on the Mayflower that landed on Plymouth Rock in 1620. And he was friends with Captain Miles Standish, the two men of the 42 that conceived and signed the Mayflower Compact on a November night in 1620. A covenant between God and man, the forerunner of which the American Constitution was based.
And on the square, the maids of Manhattan for mine. You cannot see in gay Paris, in London, or in Cork.
Suzanne's dad, Lester Larson, graduated from the University of Chicago, and while there was a star halfback on the 1905 champion football team, the Maroons. In 1905, in the Big Ten championship game in front of 27,000 roaring fans, the Maroons, who were unbeaten that year, were up against the mighty University of Michigan's Athletics, who were sitting on an unbeaten streak themselves of 4 years, and were noted for reminding you of it. In this era, with five players on each side, the teams played a brilliant defensive scoreless duel for 3.5 quarters, when, on a punt return, Mark Catlin and Lester Larson sacked the runner in the end zone for a 2-zip thrilling Big Ten championship win. Les loved football and soon went on to be the head coach for the 1908 Texas A&M football Aggies, but sadly this position lasted only 2 years when Les was reported to the authorities by their maid for a major, major infraction, taking photos of his soon-to-be bride in the nude. Les's football coaching idol was Amos Alonzo Stagg, his coach with the Maroons, who went on to become a revered legendary figure in our American football chronicle. He was considered by many to be the grand old daddy of football. He played baseball and football for Yale and in 1892 began the first of 41 years as coach at the University of Chicago, the year the school opened. Stagg produced 6 Big Ten conference titles, plus a tie for 7th. He's credited with inventing numerous offensive strategies, around the end plays, the flea flicker, hidden ball plays, and the tackling dummy. He's in the College Football Hall of Fame as both a player and a coach. During one game as a pitcher for the Yale baseball team, he determinedly struck out 22 Princeton players because Mrs. Grover Cleveland, wife of the United States president, was in the stands cheering for the opponent.
Truth was mine. Joyous, free, and flaming life, for Sylph was mine.
Suzanne's mother, Adelaide Flanders Larson, was a smart, beautiful, and self-absorbed woman. Les would remind the children that to have an argument with Addie was like facing a planet-sized hell with the blower on. She had entertained, among other things, a career in show business, even squeezing her way in as a bit player under the pseudonym Dorothy Davenport. In a 1916 silent film starring the premier ballerina of the time, Anna Pavlova. The film was called The Dumb Girl of Portici, directed by Lois Weber, a pioneer filmmaker of the day. It was filmed in Los Angeles and Chicago for $300,000, an astronomical sum for 1916. Dorothy Davenport and Boris Karloff both made their film debuts in this film, with Karloff going on to become a movie legend, and sadly Davenport left another kind of legacy, a dark, toxic, transmutable one, one that seeped and sabotaged beyond the obvious reach. Ironically, 28 years later, Suzanne would star in a film opposite Mr. Karloff, Universal's The Climax, a story of a Svengali-like madman mesmerizing a beautiful operatic wonder.
Well, it couldn't be burned, the hair on the head of Shadrach. Me Shack Abednego laughing and talking while a fire wasn't jumping round. Oh, 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 me Shack Abednego. Now I'll never come as a call. Hey, yeah, when he saw the power of the Lord. And the head of big time in the house of Babylon. Shadrach. Me Shack Abednego. Ho, 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 Abednego. Woo!